substitute father in a way. He died a few years ago, but he was a photographer in Tampa, and came up to live with us for his last years. And he gave me this. This was his card. I mean, he had his time of year on the back. He said, "This is a great card. You give that to somebody, you'll keep it forever."
That's true.
Oh yeah. And so, in the use of this card, I discovered that it has a great. It has the whole philosophy of this class and what we're trying to understand. Is that, so I'll show you the psychology of it. So when I say, would you like to see my pride and joy, that's a pretty standard thing. Most people think he's going to have some baby, or his dog, or a truck, or his house, I don't know, whatever his pride and joy is, but I'm going to have to smile and say, oh, that's really nice. Whether I feel it or not, it was just a ritual. I'm just going to, you know. If you remember the Seinfeld skit, a skit where they had an ugly baby, and everybody was going, oh, you know, it's so beautiful, but inside they were going, you know. And Kramer comes in and says, that's an ugly baby.
Yeah, right.
So he was pointing out the fact. Well, then when you get the card, you see there's an expectation in the mind of seeing baby or something, and the expectation that you're going to have to put on a smile. No, so you're going to be correct. And then you look at it, and I notice when I give this to people, is that there is a momentary blank. The mind just kind of like opens because the brain is recalculating what it's actually seeing with what it expects to see. So there's a gap here between the expectation and the actual fact. He's being very literal. You want to see my pride and joy, and I'm literally, you can sit in the front. So you see that? See the difference? There's the expectation, and then there's the fact. And the laughter rises, the joy rises, when the expectation and facts collapse. When the expectation of what's real, well, if you look at a baby picture, and the fact, well, it's really a pride and joy, that's like lightning that burns up the oxygen in the thumb and the air rushes in and goes boom. Well, the air rushes in here when the gap of the expectation and the fact collapses, you see, and the boom is laughter. It's the joy of being released from an expectation of reality. Okay? So, y'all got a card, okay. So, anyway, remember that. The next time you have an expectation, right? And see, what we're gonna talk about is, and I've always known about the stages of grief, but recently I just had them written out and I began to realize that the stages of grief are part of the teaching of awakening inside awareness, what we're doing here. To explain the title, the art of aging, I have been teaching this class for 6 years. Virginia's
graduate student.
Either she's stuck and she can't get out. She's,
yes.
You know, she's in the last stages of dementia and she can't find any other class.
I don't know where else we're at.
So she's always here. And if she's not here, I think I'm in the wrong class. So I've been doing it a long time, but I've been doing the same thing, but I've changed the name every now and then just to stir things up a little bit and get somebody else. We didn't want the last class, but we'll come in to do this one, and that's the same class. Surprise, surprise. I don't teach anything. I share. I don't teach insight. I share my insight with you as it happens. So a lot of what happens in the class is my discovery of something as I do it. You know, so I'm really the student here as well. And this is kind of like the alchemy or the place where insight happens. And it happens because I don't have any expectations. Okay, now if I'm teaching a regular class in the classes that you're used to going to, which we think is the only way to teach, it's usually an expectational class. The teacher has something to teach and he writes it down, or you know, he went to school, or he's learned it and he's going to teach you that, and you have the expectation of learning what the guy's going to teach. You know, so there's a contract there. He's got something and I'm going to get it, and then I'll take it home and I'll either use it or forget it. You know, in other words, well, that's not what we're doing. At least not what I want to have my intention to happen. My intention is for this to be a discovery. So, but there is structure to it. In other words, it's just not stream of consciousness, blah, 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 you know, going on. You know, there is an intention, and the intention creates what's going to happen. And it's really miraculous that way that I've discovered in my life, that if you have the intention to be awake and aware and conscious, that intention will create the opportunities for you to be awake and aware and conscious, you see. But if you don't have that intention, well, then you just go on a tape loop until they take us out on the stretcher, you know. So we're not about that. So the art of aging, I want to get upfront about that right now. When I say aging, I'm talking about time and the fact that we start aging as soon as we're born. But we don't begin to take it seriously until we get past 50. You know, then we start seeing the age, we look in the mirror and say, oh my God, I'm not 30. You know, and so now we become aware of time, its limitation, our own mortality, and we become aware of aging. And then we go into stages of grief. The first shock is you look in the mirror and you see the wrinkles. I'm not 20. I'm not 30. I'm not 40. You know, shock. And then we go into denial. No, I'm not really aging. You know, and then we go into exercise and yoga. You know, we start changing our diet and we get plastic surgery, change our fashion, you know whatever. We're denying, we're not aging. And then we can't deny anymore, now we get angry. We get angry at, life itself. You know, we get angry, and then we try to make a deal. You know, we try to come to some deal, and that doesn't work. You can't make a deal with aging, you're going to age. Alright? And then we go into depression. You know, no meaning, I'm gone, it's all over with, but just give me some alcohol, or, you know, more pills, or whatever, you know. And then we come to acceptance. And when we have acceptance, it's, I'm okay in the world, and aging is okay. I'm okay. Yeah.
I bet the 15 of us in here have a whole different perspective on why we signed up for your class. I know I did. I know I had one of your classes before.
You did?
Okay. You know, I remember, I don't know what it was about. The theme, Asia, Art of Aging, intrigued me because I, as an individual, I'm recovering from a stroke.
Yeah.
And I'm interested in aging because I think if I was younger, I wouldn't have had a stroke.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking of aging in that sense. But then you came by me and said, I want to show you my pride and joy.
Yeah.
And so my original idea of you as an individual, to be the teacher, I see that. And I'm my workaday in the world, my whole career, I worked for Procter & Gamble.
Right.
And I sold joy.
And those are the original ones there. I mean, that you don't get pride and joy like that.
Well, I lose joy. I'm do enjoy in a different container than that person. But that's what intrigued me, because pride was made by, and still is made by, Ashley Johnson.
Yeah.
So then I thought, well, he's a poverty. In my town, we look for either Boxer Campbell or Ashley Johnson. And I looked at him and I said, there's no way you're going to Boxer Campbell. Boxer Campbell would never hire anybody out of camp.
Well, anyway, my uncle, because he was within World War II, Air Force Intelligence, and they dumped him out of Tampa, and he stayed there and became a photographer. So he probably got this picture from the 60s, you know, when not, because these are the old models here.
The Photoshop.
Yeah, so anyway, the art of aging is if you look at aging as being a lifelong process and not just something that happens when you get a particular age, we want to understand aging in a different context. And so I'm looking at it in terms of aging being as the awareness of aging is a stage of grief. In other words, I've lost my youth. And that's a grief. Right? And if we have a stroke, I've lost my physical...
The stages of grief are very similar to the stages of a stroke.
I'm saying, you know, let me get to that, because my uncle, who gave me the card, was very active up through his 80s and into his 90s. He was a photographer at home, and he had his name was Tommy Uren, at Tommy's World. He lived in Tampa and had everything just right. And whenever we went down to visit, we would go to all the restaurants that he liked, and got me addicted to martinis. And so, you know, he had a workable life. Everything worked. You know, even though his wife died, he had a new girlfriend, and, you know, whatever. So everything was working. And then he got a stroke. And it paralyzed his left or right leg, so he couldn't walk. And he refused to do therapy, and he just quit. And he said, when I went down to see him, his partner died, so I had to go down there and rescue him because he had no family down there. And we brought him back to live with us. He was kind of like a sack of sand, you know, he had to get up. We had to end up by getting him a hydraulic lift to get him out of here, 200 pound, you know, crank him up to get him into a wheelchair, you know, because he couldn't stand up. But the fact was that for the last 7 or 8 years of his life, he gave up and said, I'm ready to die. So when I went down there to meet him, he said, you know, I'm ready to die. I used to do everything, and now I can't do anything. I'm done. So basically, he had not, you know, he had gone to this place here and stopped. See, so he couldn't, you know, he went through all these and he got stuck here. Yeah.
I think that's a real critical spot there, that depression.
Yeah.
Because I think most people, when they say, well, I'm depressed, I didn't do well in the past, or I didn't do well, they're not deeply depressed. They're disappointed. And you had a stroke. Did you go through a depression? I did, and I can tell you that form of depression is not at all like I'm disappointed because I didn't do well.
Well, what the psychologists say, I'm not a psychologist, say that depression is anger turned back. And in other words, the anger is anger at something out there. You know, something, somebody, you know, usually with a stroke, you know, you can't, there's nobody that did it to you. Unless your lifestyle is something, I don't know. But the idea of depression, people, you know, is basically anger going back. So instead of energy going out in anger, because when we're angry, we feel powerful. Usually when there is a loss, I have a loss of my power, my center. I'm off center, I've lost something, I can't get my mojo back. So I gotta blame somebody. So either you did it to me or I did it to me. So the anger is gonna go wrong. But when we feel anger, we regain the sense of loss, because anger makes us feel powerful. Many people create, I know my father was that way. A lot of people had fathers, don't make your father angry. So you walk around, you know, like that, don't make him angry. Because when he's angry, he's powerful.
He's very true what he says, but coming out of that depression, it's also critical. Your relative probably never came out of his depression. But I've come out of mine, I've been through it, and your family and your friends, and...
Well, let me get back, we'll get back to that. I've got to go on, we're going to run out of time. So anyway, this what I'm trying to connect on, I just started realizing this today, that I'm seeing the stages of grief in everything. You know, not just in the big ones, you know, where somebody actually dies or we have a stroke or something like that, where there's a big or a tornado tears up my house or something, but in the little ones, you know. So we're going to look into that. Now the other thing I wanted to mention, because this is a beginning class, and it's tricky for me because I've got new people, and I've got old people, not figuratively speaking. Now people that have been here, you know, and so I don't want, you know, so I'm threading the needle here so that I'm fresh and not boring. So it's a tricky thing. So what I'm working with today, I want to get the idea is that we all come here with natural wisdom, the wisdom of natural aging. Well, we all have that, we all know it, we all experience it, because when we deal with grandchildren or children or, you know, anyone that's younger, you know, we come to them with a certain amount of wisdom and life experience that they have not had yet and don't have. So that's a natural built-in thing. I often call this the 50-plus club, because, okay, it's kind of like this. Okay. And this is 50. And here we have a okay, so here we're climbing up, we're getting stuff, we're getting family, getting a business, making money, filling our pockets, we're getting stuff. And then over here, somewhere up here, 50 plus, you know, there's a shift, and we start losing stuff. You know, people, friends die, you know, the obituaries is where everybody we know is, you know, that kind of, you know, so now we're on this downward slide, you see, and then we go out here, the abyss, you know, boom, you know, so we slide off, we don't know where that is, there's the unknown, and there's fear here, or just a discontent, or just a feeling of anxiety, or saying, you know, I've lost something, I can't get it back, and then everything is a sign that I'm losing, you know, every time somebody dies, that's just another sign, you know, that I'm going down the slide, you know, that kind of thing. On this side here, it's very optimistic, you know, death got plenty of time. Here, we're getting into no time. Or, you know, in other words, there's a change in time going on here, you know, from the, I got plenty of time. If you're 20, you can smoke 3 packs a day, and you've got plenty of time to quit. You know, I'll quit tomorrow, you know. So you got plenty of time here, and here's not so much. So the grief then comes in, you know, as a time factor to it, and an expectation, loss of expectation. You know, this isn't the way it was supposed to be. I remember the movie Sand Pebbles. Did anybody ever see that movie, Sand Pebbles? It was a movie about China, the riverboat, the American riverboats in China before the World War II. This was Steve McQueen. And my father was on one of them. There were only two composite things that happened. And the thing that sticks out to me was that there was the Steve McQueen character on this film was a man who was in his true nature. He always did the right thing at the right time. He was always centered in himself. And so some missionaries got in trouble up in the upper river, and he had to go up and, he didn't want to, but he had to go up and rescue them. And they were trapped by the Chinese nationalists coming in, and he had to stay behind where, so they could escape. And he gets shot, and he's sitting there leaning up against the post, you know, and shot and dying. He says, it wasn't supposed to end this way. It wasn't supposed to end. That was not part of his story. And, but I, you know, that whole idea of the pride and joy. You know, in other words, there's the expectation that you're going to have pride and joy, but you get a stroke. You know what I mean? There's the loss of the expectation, and not the actual fact, but the expectation that is the loss. So we're really dealing with two levels here. There is the actual fact of the pride and joy. It's just the pride and joy. So there's the actual fact of the stroke, or the actual fact of losing my health, or losing, you know, I'm starting to fall apart, and all the actual fact of it. And then on top of that, there is the expectation that's being disappointed. It shouldn't be this way. You see what I mean? So it's the grief comes in, not from the fact. There's no grief in the fact. The grief is the loss of the expectation that it shouldn't be this way. So, my friend Errol, who's a videographer, told me this story about two geese fights. She was a little girl, and there was a fence, and there was a goose. And so she went up to the fence, like curious. Right? And so she sticks her finger there, and the goose bites it. And so she cries. Okay, so that's the first goose bite. That's just the fact. But then the second bite came in when the parents blamed the girl for sticking her finger in the goose, you see. So now the parents were fighting her for being curious. See, so now that puts you in that now, you see what the double bind, the double bite, we're always doing that. We're always, there's the fact, and then there's the bite. My daughter, who is a singer in New York with Led Zeppelin, it's a female tribute band for Led Zeppelin, and she's getting ready to go on tour with a Broadway play called Hedwig and the Angry Inch as an understudy, and she'll be performing. So she's going to be on tour for a year, and she had this life in New York for the past 10 years, where she had an apartment, and she was in the band, and she had these other jobs, but she realized that it was beginning to tape loop, and she wasn't growing anymore. So she decided to go on this tour and get rid of the apartment. So she, and she's 45, so she loaded up 10 years of stuff, rented a U-Haul truck, this is in Queens, got the truck there, looked down one stairs, brought all this stuff down one stair, flight of stairs, put it in the truck, drove the truck all night to Blackstone, put the stuff in it, we had a little storage shed and an extra room and some extra closets, unloaded all the stuff, and then she was in the guest room, so it was up to here with stuff, and then she collects stuff, clothing and things, you know. So she doesn't just have a suit of clothes, she has maybe 5 or 10 variations of stuff she picks up that she can just, I don't know what it's called, but she can just throw stuff together and go out looking great, you know, with odds and ends that she picked up and, you know, whatever. So she gets it all stored up, and then she has to go to, then we have to, the last day she's still packing, and she's got a 5 o'clock, she kept her bus, she's got six bags, going to put six bags on the bus, go to New York so she can get ready to go on the tour. And she has to pack for a year. So she's doing all that, and the bus, 5 o'clock bus, well, there's a 5 o'clock bus, well, we can't make that. Well, there's an 8:30 bus, well, we're not going to make that. So we finally make the 11:30 bus. so we have to leave Blackstone, live in Blackstone. And say, I have to leave Blackstone at an hour and a half before. So we finally get the bags and she got everything stored. She get on the bus, get there, rush there, and the bus is late, so we have a little time. And then she has this big water bottle. And then she's leaning over, fixing her bags, and she spills the water bottle in her. And she just breaks it. You know, she just starts crying and she's angry at herself. So angry at herself, boy. Oh, I've ruined my computer, I've ruined my electronics, you know, I'm stupid. You know, so that, you know, right there, and if she'd have done all that accomplishment. And now that one little thing, you see, that one little thing just broke the dam. And I said, it's okay, it's just water, and nothing was ruined, we just mopped it up. And she was okay, and she caught the bus, and she got the beam. But it just struck me in my mind, you know, that the expectation that I can perfectly do this, that I won't screw up. And then when you have that expectation that you won't screw up, guess what's going to happen? You're going to have a surprise. Something's going to happen that you didn't plan for. When you're relaxed, you're going to spill something. That's like in the movie Great Escape. You remember that? When they were trying to escape, they escaped the prison camp and they were all dressed up as civilians. And they had to get through the Gestapo on pairs. And some of them were getting through and some were getting caught. So this too, they were really cool. And so they got through, they were getting on a train and there was the Gestapo and there were papers and all that, got through. And so they get on the train and the Gestapo guy says, have a good day. Oh, right, mate. So, you know, when we try, we have the expectation we're going to do it, I'm going to make it, and there is going to be a hole in that try where there is going to be a grief. You know, there's going to be a shock. My God, I can't believe I just did it. We all do that. I do it all the time. What I've learned is that I program that in. So I have the expectation that I'm going to screw up. I don't know how, but I know I will. So I don't worry about it. So when I'm doing something and I knock over this and it spills, the doing something and the spill is all seamless. In other words, you're doing something, you spill something, you clean it up, you go on, and there's no spike. There's no, there's no, you see what I mean? It's just seamless. There is no meaning to the spill because it's a fact. The meaning comes in because we have an expectation I'm not going to spill something. So the spill then is a validation that I'm a failure, which is my big fear, you see. Yeah.
It is a point that I agree with you that you cannot go too much into. Oh, I spill it and be in shock. But at the same time, I think it's a very healthy dose to have the disappointment that makes you be a better person.
You can learn. I'm not saying you don't learn from it. I'll be more careful. I'll remember that, you know. But I think what I'm pointing out is the self-flagellation. Breaking down in tears, huh? You know, that whole self-flagellation is what we're... The self-flagellation is what the grief, because that's grief. The shock of doing something you didn't expect, you see. And then the denial, the anger, the make a deal, and so forth, you know. And then acceptance is I'm okay and the world is okay. Okay, this is transactional analysis. I just dug up an old book in my bookshelf that I hadn't read since the 70s. Because I'm okay, you're okay. And I know it's old because the print is really small. And you get these old paperbacks and you can't read it. they pack a lot of stuff into a little book there. But anyway, I'm okay, you're okay. It basically is the final stage of being okay. You know, you go through all these different stages, but I'm okay, you're okay, is I'm at peace with myself and the world. Okay? And in the, and so this kind of like in the stages of grief is where we want to get to when we go through a loss. And again, the idea of the loss is very subtle. Well, we think of loss as being big stuff. But it's very subtle. It's like, you know, spilling the wine on the table. You know, when everybody's ready to sit down, you know, and oh, what a dumb, you know, so that, you know, what a stupid person I am. That, you know, that's the anger turns, you know, you go shock. You can't say, I didn't spill it. And they say, well, I didn't do that, he did it. He's Mr. Bean. I've been watching Mr. Bean lately, and he's always, you know, he'll do something and somebody else did it, you know. So he denies it, you know. Then you get angry at somebody who did it, or you did it, you know, still. And then you make a deal, you know, well, that's can happen to me, and I always feel stuff, you know, that's what I do, I'm so sorry. Now, when we're in this stage here, we're in the stage of shame or sorry. We know people who are sorry for everything. You make up stuff to be sorry for. I mean, if I walk through that thing and I hit that, some of my friends will say, I'm sorry, and she was sitting over there. this is because we're in a stage of grief and we're carrying the depression of, I'm sorry. Okay? This is, I'm sorry. I'm just a sorry. You know, that becomes an attitude. So I really, I've been excited about, interested in really trying to put the stages of grief in the context of awakening Dharma wisdom. Now Dharma wisdom, let me get this word here, Dharma. Because I practice or apply in my personal life the what's called Buddha Dharma, or the Dharma means teaching, or the teaching of Zen, which is my favorite. But this doesn't mean I exclude Jesus, yoga, Christianity, or anything else. So it's all teaching. But I lean towards the language of an understanding of Zen and Buddhism, which you can say is the Dharma. So Dharma means not the truth of some particular tradition or philosopher or theory or psychology. It is life truth. And so Dharma is basically something we have to, when I discover a truth, I have to discover it. You can't tell me what's true, I have to discover it myself. So truth is subjective, in other words, truth is my truth. And I have to discover it in my life, or not in your life. You can have a truth, and you can share it, but you can't teach it, you can't give it to me. In the same way, everybody lift your arm. Just lift your arm up. And now tell me how you did that. You see, because I can't lift my arm. How do you do that? See, it'd be very difficult to do that. You can't do it. You can describe, let's say, well, I think about lift my arm. Well, think about it. You see, I don't know how I'll lift my arm. I just do it. You do it. I don't know how to do it. You see? So it's kind of like truth is kind of like that. You just do it. And you can't explain it. You can share it, but you can't teach it. So it's kind of always kind of like that. So we're looking at two wisdoms here. And this is why I really love working here with y'all, because you already come with the wisdom of aging. You know, this is not a class of 20-year-olds. We have no life experience, so we have a lot to talk about. A lot to work with. We have a lot of loss to work with. Let's see. And so the whole idea behind this Dharma teaching is that you work with the facts or the life that you've got. So if you had loss, you say, oh, great, let's work with that. What does loss mean? What does loss mean? Not who did it to me, or why I'm losing something, but what is it? You know, I'm curious about that. So that's one aspect here, is that when I say the word Dharma, I'll keep rediscovering what it means myself. So we'll keep working with that word. Another thing I want to mention before I forget, periodically I'll be handing out some talks by Rodney Smith, who is a Dharma teacher for the Insight Meditation Society in Seattle. And there's a website, seattleinsight.org, on which he has all the talks he's been given for the last 10 or 12 years. And so I really recommend that you go there and check out some of his talks and just explore, which I've been doing for years. And so when I come across one, I listen to it, keep them in my car when I drive, I'm driving to my co-pilot. We go someplace together, you know. So I'll hand those out periodically, and I encourage you to check that out. And if I recommend an author to read, I would recommend Eckhart Tolle, two books, Power of, anybody read his books, Power of Now and New Earth? Yeah. When I first discovered him back in 2005, every morning my wife and I would get up and we'd get his tapes and we'd listen to his tapes, you know. So it was like a morning coffee and listen to Eckhart. So this practice that we're working with here, the art of aging, or the art of living in time, so that you're not depressed by time, the art of living in time, is a practice. And it's not something that you just learn and forget about. So it has to become a lifestyle practice. So what I'm encouraging for this 15 weeks is that I'm going to be saying, I handed out that everybody got a manual. Okay. What I just handed out, let me go through that while we're getting this. And before we end, we'll do the first practice and we'll go to meet you. The first page, what I wrote here is the transcript from the Yoga Nidra. Let me see if I'm jumping around here. The Yoga Nidra CD that I gave you. One of these, the orange one, okay, is a guided meditation that has five exercises. And I've been using this for the last 6 years. It's kind of like what you can do at home to orientate you to this wisdom. So this class, again, is not where you're going to be learning something and then memorizing it and going home and thinking about it. It is a practice that reorientates your whole life towards aging in time. It's like a chiropractic adjustment where you get realigned with true life, with your life. If there is grief, you are out of alignment because you feel like you've lost something, but nobody loses anything. When you imagine we've lost something and we grieve, then we go through the stages and seeing all that. But we're not looking at the fact, you see. So anyway, the first part here in italics is just the first transcript of what the instructor, the voice says on the tape, and we'll get that. But I put it down here so we could go back at it because it really sets us up for the whole wisdom practice. Let me read it to you. Well, we'll do this in a little bit, at least we have plenty of time. Welcome to Yoga Nidra. Yoga Nidra, by the way, means, Nidra means sleep, Yoga means awake. So it's a paradox, awake, sleep. So the practice is the sleep that awakens you. In other words, the sleep part is putting the monkey mind or the puppy mind to sleep. The first puppy mind has to get still, which is what we do. Okay, so he goes on to say, welcome to the meditative part of yoga. It's a very ancient practice. If you've ever had a yoga class, and at the end of the yoga class, you lie down in the corpse pose, you're doing yoga nidra. Usually the instructor will take you on a little guided meditation. You know, it could be, I remember the first time I did it, it was like, clench the left side of your face, now relax. Now your left arm, relax. So you go through the body, relax, relax. So this one is different. It's put up by Richard Miller, and he teaches this all over the country. So reading on, as your body begins to settle, close your eyes. Now you can do yoga nidra lying on your bed, you can do it sitting in a chair. I do it sitting in the chair. You can lie on the floor, you can lie on the bed. You can put a cover over your eyes so that no light will bother you, or not. Set your attention free to wander through your senses. Note the sounds in the room and the images and thoughts that are passing through your mind, and the feelings in your body. Now right there, this is a meditation. Sit on the back porch and notice the birds. Or sit like in my house, on the back porch I hear birds, on the front porch I hear traffic. I have the best of two worlds. But listen to the sounds. We all do this, but we don't really know we're doing it. But you listen to the sounds without naming them. You listen to the sounds, you don't say, well, that's a crow, that's a robin, oh, what is that? See, that's puppy mind. You listen to the sounds as sounds. You don't know what they are, you don't care. It's sound. It could be the same with traffic. You just hear sounds, and you don't bother with, oh, that damn truck, or that guy needs to be fixed. Or you do it with Walmart. You go to Walmart, and you can just be aware of forms without saying, oh, that's a bad one. You know what I mean, or what? You know, the puppy mind, judging, complaining, valuing, well, that's good, that's bad, they need to fix that. Look what she's doing to her child. You know, all this stuff, you know. You just go and you just open aware, you're just looking. You're not judging, you're not evaluating, you have no meaning at all. It's just visual. Sit on the back porch, just birds, just sound. Not even birds, it's just sound. It's amazing what you discover. So we're doing that with the yoga nidra, with body senses. Please allow my words to become your words as we enter into this meditative journey together. Now this is important. Now the instructor is saying, okay, folks, you can take a little vacation from thinking. You don't have to worry. You don't have to be wondering what's next. You don't have to know whether you left your clothes in the dryer or not, or what you're going to do with the store in a few minutes. You just let all that go. And just let my voice be your voice and relax. You don't have to do a single thing. Period. Take a vacation from your own body mind. Realize the timeless wisdom that lies hidden within you. Okay, timeless wisdom. Well, timeless wisdom, the first wisdom up here is the wisdom of aging, is the wisdom of time. I've got time in this house. I know how it's running, you youngster. You see, I've been in this prison for a long time. I know how it works, and you're just sucking your thumb, you know. So let me tell you what, so I got the wisdom of time. But the wisdom of Dharma is timeless, you see, because it's not referencing time. It's always now. So the wisdom of Dharma is realize the timeless wisdom that lies hidden within you. So the timeless wisdom is hidden within us. All we know is the wisdom of time. You see, but the timeless wisdom has to be awakened when we give up the wisdom of time. You can't have both of them at the same time. You see? So in the yoga nidra, in this reference here, the wisdom of aging is the sleep of time, and the wisdom of Dharma, the timeless, is the awakening through the transparency of time. You know, so time and aging becomes transparent. And we see the true facts of my life through through the film of, oh my God, I'm getting old, which is the wisdom of time, or not the wisdom of time. So realize time is wisdom, like hidden within your unchanging true nature. So unchanging true nature means that there is something in me that is timeless. And we all know this. We look in the mirror and say, oh my God, look, I got the wrinkles. But there's something in us that is timeless. We all sense that. You can't really grab it. You know, it's a sense, you know, that I'm really deathless, I'm really timeless. And this body, this time, and this aging, and so it's kind of like a film over that, you see. But there's something within that is unchanging true nature. And it's that, and it says that your unchanging true nature is heartfelt equanimity or presence. Equanimity is this right here. I'm okay, the world, you and the world is okay. Now, equanimity means I'm at ground zero. You see, there's nothing wrong, there's nobody to blame. I maybe have cancer, but it's okay. With this realization, powerful image or presence, that is in every circumstance of your life. So, in this sense, every moment is the window to time's wisdom. It's not in the future, it's always going to be now, but it has to be seen now, not can't see it tomorrow, and didn't have it yesterday. It's always going to be, so it's always going to be a discovery. Now is always a discovery. As soon as it's not a discovery, it's yesterday. You see, but the moment right now, we think we know what it is, but basically it's always open to a surprise. We can always discover something, even when we think there's nothing there. We all experience that. We go to a party. I went to a backyard dinner that these people have every 5 years or something. And 6 years ago I went, and it was kind of like, you know, you go to one, you know, and you know, I went to the store yesterday, and, you know, and that, you know, and you have your thing, and time, you know, I've got this TV program I want to get back to, you know. I've got this big drink of scotch I would rather be having, or something, you know. So you go on, you go home, and you have a good time. Yeah, I had a good time. But you really didn't. So I went last night, and had a great time. I have a good time when I go to one of these, when I can get with somebody and have a conversation. I'm not good at group chit-chats where five people are telling five different stories at the same time. And I can never get in. I want Moses to part the Red Sea. You know, okay. I want to say something, and you're not trying to say, and then I'm stepping on somebody else. You know, and they override me. And then when I want to say something, the thing has moved on, and it doesn't sound relevant. I had a good thing, but now it's gone. I just don't function well in that, and that's okay. But when I can sit down with somebody who's open, I can have a great conversation. And we kind of like explore things and change back and forth, and it's really good, you know. So I had one of those last night, and I had a really good time, and I got enjoyment. So I surprised myself, you know. And then when I went to, it's always going to be like the last time. But I went, and we all had that experience. So with this realization, you recover your true radiant health and disposition to meet, greet, welcome, and respond to every situation that you face during your lifetime. This is the biggie. That you, with this realization of your timeless wisdom or true nature, you recover your true radiant health and disposition. You recover your disposition to meet, greet, and welcome every moment. See? So you're greeting every moment without the expectation that it's going to be some ugly kid. See what I mean? So you greet this with the expectation it's going to be this guy's pride and joy. And then you actually meet the moment, which is this, and you say, oh, it's great. It's funny. See? So every moment is great if you meet it without the expectation that it's going to be a bad moment. So, but we have to discover that. It's not something that can, yeah, that really makes sense, but we don't do it. So that's where the practice comes in. So the last line is, with this realization, you recover your true radiant health and disposition. Now, your radiant health, it's not your clinical diagnosis of your health, where you've got the diabetes and you've got the rheumatism or whatever that is. You know, that's just the house. You're dragging it. Joe Fry, you know, just the facts. You know, the facts is I got the rheumatism. But that's not my radiant health. The radiant health comes from your disposition to meet the rheumatism with laughter. So if you meet the rheumatism as a fact, it's okay, I've got the rheumatism. Or the arthritis. It's just a fact, you know. It's just life. I've got the arthritis, you know. But I welcome it instead of going into the stages of grief. Oh God, I've got this deal arthritis and I can't get in, it's getting worse, you know, and all. Why did this happen to me? I did so good, you know. Nobody else in my family's got it, you know, and now I've got it. You know, what did I do? You know, now we're going through all of this, you see. And basically end up with, I'm not okay. So this final one is really sets us up, because with this realization, you recover your true nature, your true radiant health and disposition to meet, greet, and welcome. Now, when we welcome, that means it's like the doorbell rings, and you go to your door, and there's somebody with another race, or they're shaggy, or they're unkempt, or you don't know who they are, or there was rumors of a sex predator in the state, and oh my God, he's here, or something, and you go to the door with an expectation that this is going to be a bad experience. Now, so you lock, you keep the door locked, and you look through the door. You know. Or do you just go to the door, you know, and you open it, and you say hi, or hello. You know. So there's no, in other words, you go to the door of the mind with that welcoming, because you do not know the future. You know the past, but this moment is not the past unless you project the past on it. And it's a problem, you see. So if you open the door of the moment with a welcoming, the moment responds to you in like, you see. You see? So the moment responds with a smile. Even if it was somebody who was going to come to rob you. I can't rob this person, he likes me. You can flip the whole thing. Respond to every, so respond, or respond to every situation. Now, there's a difference between reaction and responding. So if I go to the door and I'm uncertain about the nature of the person there, because I don't know them, or we live in a small town, And people in small towns, they know everybody, and so if somebody is stranger or doesn't fit right or something, or is in the wrong neighborhood or something, you know, there's a little bit of uncertainty there. Who is that? A little bit of fear. You know, I don't know, I'm uncertain what's going to happen. The future's uncertain. Future is time. Time is uncertain. I don't know what's going to happen. I'm afraid. So when you meet that moment, when you open the door, that's the moment. When you meet the moment with that expectation, you're going to be reacting. You are reacting to the moment. You see? If you open the door with a welcome, now the moment becomes potentially creative. So now you're going to respond to the moment creatively, because you don't know what's going to happen. You're curious. You open the door with curiosity. Who is this wonderful person that's come to my door, even though they're dressed like a bum? That's just an expectation. Who is this person? I welcome this person. And so you're really welcoming yourself. As soon as we define the other person, I've defined myself. As soon as I define the moment, as soon as I define the party is going to be a bust, I have defined myself as somebody who's a bust. You see, I've just defined myself as somebody who's a bust. You see, but I define myself, that's painful. That is not being, I'm okay and you're okay, you see, that's being I'm not okay. But I want to get okay when I get home. But here, I'm not okay. So that's a posture. That's a negative yoga posture. I'm fixing myself in a yoga posture of not being happy with this moment, you see. And everybody knows it. No, he's always there. All right, so that anyway, well, when we do the exercise, you know, that is the opening, so now you're getting a little familiar idea. So this, the reason this is so important, because this is the only time he sets us up in this meditation here. And this is the way, the orientation of the whole practice. So we have to practice realizing timeless wisdom. You just can't snap your fingers and start doing it. You have to catch it. You have to catch yourself being in time and realize that you are timeless. So you have to discover the timeless in aging. You can't discover the timeless unless you have something to work with. And aging is the best thing to work with, let me tell you. Because it's kind of like working with cigarettes. Habit, you always got it. You know, in other words, you've always got a cigarette. If you're working with cigarette desire, you're really doing good because you've always got a new cigarette desire to work with. It's not like you just got one. I mean, every 10 minutes, you got a new desire. I want a cigarette. So you've got something to work with. Well, aging is always getting you a new pain, a new something to work with, you know. So it's really a great practice. So we'll be working with that this 15 years. The next thing, she did it on both sides. Okay. On this side here, integrative restoration. Now this practice, Yoga Nidra, is redesigned by Richard Miller, and he calls it integrative restoration or iris. So if you go to the internet, you get IRS.com, that is the name of, you didn't get, oh, I got another one here. I'm sorry, I'm just, yeah, so if you go check this, so the reason I put, you know, so this was kind of like a readout from some of his information. So this Yoga Nidra practice, besides the way we're using it as a guided meditation, is being taught and used all over the nation, particularly for post-traumatic syndrome, which is anybody going through a stage of grief. So it really works with the stages of grief, whether the grief mix gives you insomnia, or whether you have, see, it gives a list, you know, a lot of fears, memories, it goes through things. So negative emotions, beliefs and traumas that are present in the body, restoration. So anyway, the practice itself is a tool in order to transcend the negativities of the mind, the emotions, and the physical effects that the body has from the negative mind. When our mind is stressful, the body's going to have some kind of stress in it. We go to the doctor and he gives us a pill for the body, but not the mind. So the stress is there and the body's trying to just keep trying to catch up. So this really gets to the root. So this is kind of like an overlay of the, and it's been going on for a number of years with a lot of success. I know what, you know, people I work with, the most common thing they report is relief from insomnia. My relief for insomnia is meditation. So I'll wake up, I go to bed at 10, I might wake up at 2 or 3, may have to pee or have to work or have to, you know, wide awake. So I get up and I have a chair there and I have a little time and I can sit there and meditate. So I'll meditate for an hour, then I go back and get in bed and go right to sleep. So I work with So that's the way I work with it. I don't even know if it's insomnia. I just wake up and then I meditate. But I know I can't go back to sleep unless I get up and meditate. So instead of resist, because if you resist it and deny it, you're getting into grief. See? Oh, I got the insomnia. Shock. I'm supposed to be able to sleep. Denial. Get angry. I know I'm angry. I'm really upset because I got the insomnia. See? Well, I'll make a deal. I'll go have some tea. Maybe, you know. And then I'm on with it. I just can't get enough sleep. I'm depressed. So you can really find these stages, you know, in a lot of different areas. So then here I discovered in my little file on my computer a whole bunch of little charts that I had written up. And yoga was like the Lewis and Clark adventure, where it's an unknown land. Our body is an unknown land, and we're going to go on an exploration. And nothing is named. No maps. Or a yoga nidra is a funhouse. So when you sit to meditate, you know, the whole point of guided meditation is to, it's kind of like a rain barrel next to the house that has accumulated silt in the bottom. And as the silt accumulates, you're getting less water. So maybe you start out with a full clear barrel. And over time, the silt accumulates, and now maybe you've got half a barrel of water. And then you've got a quarter, you know, now you're up to a quarter, you know. Well, how do you get, and when the water flows out the top, but it's just the silt stays there. So how do you get back to a full, clear mind, right? So you start off with a clear mind, and then with time, it begins to look like that. Well, how do you get it out? Well, you just stop moving. And it settles out. But this is what freaks people out with meditation and this practice, is that, using the analogy of the barrel, so how do you get the silt out? Well, you have to stick a big shovel in there, and you got to stir it when the water's flowing out all the time. You see, so you got to stir the silt out. And the silt gets caught up in the water and overflows. So eventually, by stirring the silt, the water clears, and you're back to your original clear mind. Okay, so it's a process of deconstructing the accumulations that we of beliefs and worries and fears and all this crap that we accumulate, you see. With time, we have to deconstruct it. So there's a science to that, and we'll be working with it. So what I came up with here, I've forgotten when I wrote it, but I wrote a whole series of called Puppy Mind Training Manual, and wrote a poem. I have a puppy mind. Why do I have this puppy? I have a puppy mind. God gave it to me when I was born. It runs here and there, peeing and pooping in my home, and makes tangles in my hair. My puppy will not sit when I want to be still. It will not look where I point. It will not fetch what I want to get. All it does is bark at this and whine at that. I wonder why God gave me this dog. Wherever I go, my puppy mind goes too. It gives me no rest. I wish I could train my puppy mind. Then it could be any kind of dog I want it to be. So then I go and list the dogs I want it to be. If I wanted to build a science project, I'd get an A at school. My husband would carry the load. If I wanted to solve a problem at home, my St. Bernard would go to the station. If I lost something treasured, my fox charity would find it all. If I wanted to find the truth, my bird dog would point his nose at me. And so we go on, we can do that. And then when I wait, my colleague will be there to greet me. And then I think I will train my puppy mind. So then we go and be at ease, puppy mind. And this is how to train my puppy mind. Every day I take into a class for 20 minutes, which is the meditation, either in the early morning or when I get from school or before I go to bed. My puppy and I do this together, even though he cries and whines and wants to do something different. That's what puppies do. In my class, I lie down on the floor with a towel behind my neck and arms spread out with palms up. I put my training course on my iPod or CD player and listen to the 15 minutes. I say at ease or eye rest training, but it's the open ear. Puppy mind at first will not listen to the instruction very well, and he will want to run around thinking about everything and nothing. it's a game, you see, between me and my body mind. I can read more about this practice, and then I say, you know, I was. As the puppy mind begins to train, I feel stronger and more in control of my life. My mind is calmer and I have good thoughts instead of bad ones. Puppy mind is almost grown now, and wherever I go, he obeys me and is always by my side. When I need him, he is there. When I don't need him and I want to be still, he lies down and takes a nap. Now I know why God gave me this puppy mind. He wanted me to learn how to train it to obey my commands and to be a fearless friend. By training my puppy mind also trains me to be strong and sure and at ease. I love my puppy mind because my puppy mind is me. So I don't know when I wrote that, but I was, you know, on a roll. Sometimes you get these little things going and you can never go back and do it again.
Ibress.com, and in here it says Ibress.
Yeah, well, they changed it.
But it is com.
I hope so. I don't know. Don't want to. Maybe not. We'll check it out. If you go to Seattle and... Oh, Ash screwed up here. That Rodney Smith is Rodney's. You can Google Rodney Smith or Seattle Insight. But
that's correct.
But Yoga Nidra. You just Google I rest, and the website will come up. Google's really great. I mean, it just figures out what you want and gives it to you. Misspell it, it doesn't care. Autocorrect, not so good. It will create words I have no idea created. I'll look back and, oh, jeez, did I say that? So anyway, then the first basic training, sit. Right. How to make my puppy mind be at ease. I call this dog fidget. So all these, I'm going to have one of these little puppy mind training lessons each week. Will give you something to play with during the week. And of course, the first thing to play with the puppy mind, is the first exercise in Yoga Nidra. A lot of this, well, we're going to have to get to that pretty soon. Let me just say one more thing before we do the exercise, is that the beginning stages of the puppy mind training is basically teaching the mind how to be focused, still focused. So the exercise gives you something to focus on in the mind, like breath. Just focus on your breath, follow the breath. And puppy mind is going to go run all around sniffing everything else in the world, you see. And every time you notice puppy mind going off, you come back and say, breath. And puppy mind runs off and you come back, breath. So basically this is boot camp for the mind, where you are training the mind to be still long enough for you to see the timeless wisdom, right? In other words, timeless wisdom cannot rise in your life if your mind is running all over the place. It just won't happen. So the first stage is more like concentration, training the mind to just relax and let go, which it doesn't want to go because it doesn't want to go into grief. You see, the mind clings to stuff because it feels like if I let go, I'm going to lose something. Try to clean out your house, and everything is good. And everything is, well, I haven't used this for 10 years, but somebody gave it to me. You know, and I just don't want to throw it away because somebody gave it to me. And so I put it back, you know. Or, like my wife, well, I wouldn't throw it away, but somebody might need that. So I put it back over there, and they'll give it to somebody, and it stays there for another 10 years. So basically, That's a way of barter. You see, I make a deal. I don't want to let it go. I make a deal. I'll give it to somebody else. I'll put it over there in that box. And then the box is still there. So you got the deal. You didn't suffer the loss.
Yeah. It strikes me that breathing is involuntary.
Yeah.
And I read once someone was asking a question, what would it be like if breathing was voluntary? and you forgot to breathe.
Yeah, right. It's a funny thing. Now, there's two things to that. I'm glad you brought that up. But first of all, the breath is the bridge between the mind and the body. You can control your breath to a certain degree. But at some point, the breath is going to breathe. Okay? In deep meditation, you'll discover that you stop breathing. When you get really still, maybe you don't stop so much as you just don't breathe much at all. It just gets a little... You know, like that. You know, just a little... And you have the thought, my God, I'm hardly breathing. You know, that kind of thing there gets very still. When you're angry or panic. So you can watch the breath as kind of like a measurement of what your mind's doing. So the meditation using breath is very great because that is the only area where you can actually do something with the mind. Influence. So you can regulate, this yoga is all about breathing, you know, regulating the breath. It's using the breath in order to control the mind. And this is not using the breath, it's watching the breath. So this is not into effort, not into doing stuff and getting into postures and doing all means to it. This is just learning how to look. So let's do the first exercise, yoga nidra. If everything works here. Okay. Just a few things. This is a very powerful practice, and the only way for you to realize that is for you to use it when you need it. For instance, during this week, notice your mind and see if you get into a worry state, if you get into some kind of a complication, or mostly it's worry. What's going to happen? Worry, that's time. What's going to happen in the future? I got this worry. And you'll see it's a little bit of a tape loop. That's what worry does. Well, when you notice that, go and put this, sit down and listen to this first session. Okay? And when he sets the intention, set your intention for your immediate needs. And you set it like, my true nature is free of worry. I am free of worry. I'm okay. I'm free of worry. I'm okay. That's your intent. So that's not saying, I'm not okay now and I want to be in the future. That's the way most people pray. You know, I'm in a fix now and I want to be out of the fix, so help me God get out of the fix. But that really affirms your fix. You know, in other words, the universe is saying, you believe you're in a fix, so I'll give you what you believe, or you're going to stay in that fix. But if you affirm yourself not being in a fix, the universe or God will give you what you affirm, which is, I'm okay. So then you affirm that, I'm okay, and then you go through, then you let go of your worry, your thinking, his voice is now your voice. So you just let go of your dysfunctional thinking, drop it, I'll pick it up when I come back, it's out there, you know, don't have to worry, you'll still be out there waiting for me if I want it. And then you go through the exercise, the practice, and see what happens. Because you're disconnecting yourself from the worry. And our true nature is not worry. So you're connecting with your true nature. Why pick it up again? You see, in other words, you're giving yourself a chance to get disconnected so you can let Dharma wisdom come up. And you see that there's really nothing, you know, it's just a fact. You know, it's not a worry. There's a fact and then there's a worry. You know, but the fact is not the worry. So we have to discover that, yeah.
The puppy state is so strong, and I'm sure it's not just me.
No.
But I mean, very difficult.
This room is full of yapping dogs.
So the more we use this, the better we'll be able to focus.
Well, right. So you do just this exercise right here.
Yeah.
Now the practice, what you're looking for here, is, and we get into this, like, well, I'm supposed to listen to the voice, and I'm listening, and then, but the puppy mind takes me off, and I'm running off thinking about, well, this is silly, or wait a minute, yada, yada, you know. And then you remember breath, and you come back. Well, what a lot of people will do is that, well, I can't do this. You know, something's, you know, this is just too much for me, forget about it. Because we don't like not succeeding. You know, we don't like not being good. So then we come back, well, I just can't do it, so I'd rather than feel the not being good or okay, I won't do it. That way, I barter, you see. In other words, I can't do it, so, you know, make, well, I'll do it tomorrow. I'll be in a better mood tomorrow, but no, tomorrow never comes. So, but that's not the purpose of the practice. The practice is to forget. The practice is to see yourself forgetting. In other words, the practice is to remember. But you can't remember unless you forget. You see? So the puppy mind has to be there for the practice. You can't train the puppy mind unless you've got a puppy. See, so the puppy mind is going to forget. But then the training is to remember. And so as soon as you remember, the remembering is timeless wisdom. You see? So that right there is the awakening. The remembering is the awakening of the timeless, still memory or awareness, you see. So the remembrance is the awakening. And you need the forgetting in order to awake. That's the way the game goes. So you have to understand that. So the more you forget, the better off you are. In that sense, you know, because you have something to work with. And in time, you stay with the practice more than you forget and go off in the puppy mind, you see. So it works. The more you remember, the longer you stay remembering, which is basically just doing what you're doing, just being present. Remembering is not doing anything, it's just being present with your breath and the voice. So being present with the voice is just listening to the voice and not talking to the voice. If I'm talking to it, what is he saying? Well, that's just, you know, whatever, yeah.
How long was that recording?
I think that's about 12 minutes.
Really?
Yeah, the other ones are shorter. Yeah. So because this is long because it sets you up.
Okay, there's two of them.
Now, one of them is a talk by Rodney Smith on Wisdom of Aging.
Which one did you play?
Yoga Nidra.
Okay, thank you.
They're both audio CDs.
Okay.
So this really is, the thought came to me, you know, like I like to connect this teaching up with Christianity. Catholicism is my favorite, because that's so rich. But even in the Protestant churches, when you go to the Protestant church or the Catholic church, there is communion. The Catholic, it's Mass. In the Protestant church, it's communion. And there'll be, when I used to go to the Presbyterian church, because my mother went there, and we go there, and there'll be a big table in the front, in remembrance of me, across the front. And you have your little stuff, there'd be like a corpse, would be the stuff would be covered up, you know, or a magic act. You know, they're going to have a magic act here, you know. But the point, you know, the whole point is remembering something, you know. Once a week, Catholics do it more, once a week or every day, you know, Mass is, you know, is a center. It's kind of like with a meat eater. You know, my mother, when we were vegetarian, she said, well, I can't fix a meal without the meat in the middle. So the Mass is kind of like the meat, you know. The Protestant church, well, just once a week, or maybe on Easter. You know, it's a big deal then, you know. So, but the point is, there's a remembrance. Now, what are you remembering, you see? Well, and mostly what people remember is a historical event with Jesus. So that's an idea. I'm going to remember something, you know, in my mind. But this practice is remembering being present. So if you do the communion, I had the thought, you know, that what you're actually doing with the communion is actually tasting, if in the Catholics, you're actually tasting wine and traditionally it would be bread. They reduce it to a waste. But traditionally it would be bread and wine. You would taste that, it would be a meal. It would be nom, 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 you know. I taste it. So the taste, if you really do the communion, you are just becoming the taste. That's it. You're not saying, oh, this bread is good, or this one, wonder what vintage this wine is. I bet it's not good, you know, yada, 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 puppy mind. If you just do the taste, that's all there is. So that really is a sacrament. When you just do that and you're not puppy mind running all over, you see. So in that sense, the Mass or the communion brings you present rather than remembering something in the past, you see, which is what we do because we want to put it in time. If you take it out of time, it is timeless, and it's right now. It is just the taste of the wine and the bread. When you do this yoga nidra, it is just the taste of the sound. So when you go and become aware of your energy in your hand, you're not thinking, we're going to think about the hand, but in time we give up thinking about and we just become the energy in the hand. Just the taste of the energy. You see, that's all there is. There's no me thinking about it. That, you know, so that's where moving towards just being totally present with the fact of the moment, which is the feeling in my foot. See, so if I'm just aware of the feeling in my foot, I'm not worrying about anything. You see, I've completely disconnected myself, my being, from thinking and worrying and yada yada and all that, you see. So it's all process of disconnecting from thinking about life to being life. And being life is the energy in my body, for a start. So this week, practice this in the sense that do it, particularly if you discover yourself in a worry loop. And then, I don't know what's going to go, see what happens. Go to Walmart. And instead of worrying about, well, yada yada this, you know, do the practice in Walmart and just be aware of the energy in your feet as you walk. Or just be aware of the energy in your hand. Do that anywhere. So fruit of this practice depends on your intention and your willingness to do it as much as you can remember. So the practice is to remember to do it. No one has to know you're doing anything. You see, so you're walking to get some coffee. What are you doing? Is your mind thinking about 50 other things, or are you aware of walking? You see, if I'm aware of walking as walking, I am just being present with my life as it is this moment, you see. And I'm not worried about my life. I am my life, and it's great. Now, even if you're in a wheelchair, you know, you're okay. Okay, that's good. So anyway, thank you all for coming and starting the new class, and it'll be a lot of fun.